I am done with Windows, and I have found my Linux distro. Plural. In part 2 of this series, linked down below, I talked about how I am going to be trying out Kashi and Mint to see which one I like more and see which one I want to go to. And as I tested both of them, I realized that I like them both, and I'm going to use them for different reasons. On my main computer here, I'm going to use Kashi OS, and then on my gaming laptop, as well as my media computer, I'm going to use Mint, because I don't use them very often, and Mint is a good operating system for that. In this video, I want to go over just some of my general thoughts and experiences with both of the distros. The majority of my time on Linux was spent in Mint. That's where I did a lot of my testing. Kashi OS was mainly used to test my games and just in general familiarize myself with the OS to see whether or not I liked it. So starting off with the install process, both of them were a little bit confusing because they both had a lot of options that I didn't really know what they did. So I had to either Google it or ask AI, what is this and what is the correct option for this? Kashi especially was very daunting because it has, like, even just for the desktop environment, it has like 30 different options. So just getting to the finish line on that install was kind of rough. Once I got in though, both of them were pretty easy to get the hang of. I feel like if you've used a computer in the last 30 years, you're probably not going to have that hard of a time figuring out where a lot of the stuff is. I like that both of them have a welcome screen that goes through some basics and some places you can check out as you're getting started. I thought it was helpful, and I think that Windows should adopt that instead of just plopping you on a new OS and saying, if you have questions, go fuck yourself. Installing apps was a new experience on both distros. In my last video, I talked about how one of my concerns with Mint specifically was that I thought it wasn't updated a lot with the long-term release upgrades. Anytime I heard anyone talk about that or I heard it mentioned, my belief or how I interpreted that was that there are no updates at all for like 6+ months at a time. So your browser could be 6 months out of date. Your NVIDIA drivers could be 6 months out of date. I was very confused as to why anyone would want to use Mint, because just from a security perspective, that's a lot of updates that you're missing out on. But fortunately, I learned that that's not how it works. I guess the main Mint package is what gets updated irregularly, but the other stuff is pretty up to date. For example, my Brave browser is using the most recent version. My LibreOffice is only one version out of date. For NVIDIA drivers, I don't really play new games often, but it was concerning that if I ever did want to play a new game, I would have to be waiting a long time before I can get some game-ready drivers for that. But as I wrote this script, the most recent NVIDIA driver was about a month old, and the Windows equivalent of that Linux driver came out 2 weeks before that. So essentially, the Linux driver was about 6 weeks old compared to Windows. I'm very okay with being like a month and a half out of date for certain things like NVIDIA drivers, because even on Windows, I don't update them for like months at a time. So that was a pleasant surprise. My concern with Kashi was that the frequent updates that it did receive were going to break the system, which is something that I felt like was being echoed in a lot of the videos I watched and a lot of the threads that I read through. One of the recommendations I saw quite frequently in part 2 was people saying to just look at the patch notes before installing something, or just looking at the forums to see if anyone's having issues. And that's a great idea and something I wanted to get in the habit of doing, but not every update has notes. For example, there was a systemd update that I was getting. I had to find some command that gave me some more information about that package. In that information, I found a GitHub page, and on that GitHub page, there was no information at all with this update. I found the Arch Linux package search page, but that also didn't tell me anything. Then the Kashi forum only seems to have like monthly release notes, and I didn't see any posts about this specific update, so I kind of just assumed, I guess it's fine. One of the other suggestions I saw was making sure that you have the snapshots enabled on your system, which I did have, and as I was testing, I did play around with that a little bit. And truthfully, that did kind of ease my fears a little bit, because what I did was I updated some stuff, then used the snapshot to roll back, had no issues with that rollback, and everything worked just fine. However, one of the things I saw people say was that they don't typically go more than 2 weeks without updating Kashi, and so I decided to wait about 4 weeks in between updates. First of all, the update ran fine. It took like 12 minutes to finish, I think, but I rebooted and everything was working just fine, which is good. But then I went to see if I could try restoring from a backup, and I realized that none of the snapshots were there. Because when you boot, you have the option to go to the snapshots, and the only thing I saw was the last snapshot from like mid-October. And that was weird because my snapshots are set up to run before and after, I believe, an update is done. So I ended up finding a command that showed me all the snapshots when I logged into the computer, and I was able to see like 40 different snapshots from the updates that I had just run. For some reason, they weren't showing up in the little boot menu thing. And I never was able to find that out. I tried asking AI, I tried asking the forums, and I didn't get an answer on that. Which in this specific scenario isn't that bad. Like, I know that those snapshots are there, and if I wanted to, I could probably boot into like the USB environment or like the other environment that's available from bootloader and boot manually from command line. But it would also be nice if the snapshot menu just worked. So however much anxiety I had that was quelled by having the snapshots work before, a lot of that came right back, because what if I actually don't have those snapshots? And what if For some reason, I can't restore because they're not in the Snapchat manager. I tried from the console and they're not working. I'm still not 100% comfortable with updates on Cashy. But going back to the main thing of testing, in part, I think one it was, I talked about all the different apps and games that I wanted to make sure worked on Linux. I tested a few games on Mint, but I primarily use Mint to test out all my apps. And on Cashy is where I tested out all of my games. As far as apps go, I didn't really have any issues. A lot of the open source alternatives that I was moving to just worked. But there was one specific thing in Linux that I was not expecting to be as difficult as it was. And as far as testing goes, this is what took up the majority of my time. And that is my audio player. I have a playlist that has almost 50,000 songs in it that I've been curating for a large portion of my life. And it is like one of my most prized possessions. And truthfully, if I could not get that playlist working, this was over. I was not moving to Linux because if that playlist can't work in Linux, I'm not going there. I tried no less than a dozen different audio players, from the most popular ones that everyone recommends to just some random ones. I even installed Foobar and Winamp through Wine to see if those would work, and I was still having issues. Apps like Strawberry would just not open the playlist at all. Apps like Audacious would open the playlist, but if I tried to search, it would immediately freeze. Apps like Rhythmbox could search, but if I tried to save the playlist, if I made any changes, it would freeze. I did not think a playlist would cause so many issues, and honestly, I'm a little bit frustrated and disappointed because playlists like this have been working fine since like Windows 98, I think I remember, is when I started this playlist. I'm just not sure why it's so hard to find an audio player that can handle large playlists still in 2025. But finally, as I was going through literally every single suggestion I could find, I finally found one. I don't know how to pronounce it, but I found Quodlibe. It did everything I needed it to, and outside of slowly loading my playlist the first time I loaded it, it worked fine. Visually, it's not my first choice, but I'm kind of out of options, so I have to use it. But then on the flip side of that, there were a lot of things that worked better than they did in Windows. One of my concerns with testing games in Cashy was that I was gonna have to do a lot of tinkering to make sure they worked, but that wasn't the case. For a lot of these games, I just installed it and it worked. And if it didn't work, I would just go into Steam, select the Proton experimental compatibility, and it worked. There's games like Rocket League that I had to use like the Heroic launcher or whatever it's called to get that working. It worked perfectly fine. I got the EA app working, it worked fine. I actually laughed out loud a couple times while I was testing games. The first time being when I launched, I think it was Rocket League or World of Warcraft, and my FPS was not capped at 60. On Windows, I spent hours, and I mean hours, going through every forum. I went to Copilot, I went to Gemini, I asked them for help, trying to figure out why are all of my games capped at 60. And whatever you're about to suggest, I tried it. I asked those AI so many questions that eventually they just looped back to the beginning and started recommending the same things they had already recommended. I could not figure out why Windows 11 would cap all of my games at 60 FPS on my laptop. And then whether it was a couple of games on Mint that I tried or on Cashy OS, all of them, every single one of them, had no issues going above 60. I think it was Counter-Strike 2 that had like 500 FPS in the menu that I had to turn down because it was like ruining my computer. And the second thing was Battlefield 3. If you don't know or if you don't remember, this was the Battlefield where you had to launch a web browser to join a server. On my Windows computer, if I try to join a server, I get an error saying that I don't own Battlefield 3. But on Cashy, the only thing I had to do was install an extension on my browser so I could have like Windows 7 compatibility, and then it just worked. Again, like the hour or two that I spent troubleshooting Battlefield 3 on Windows was for naught because it will just work on Cashy. Outside of gaming and the apps that I tested, there are a few things that I did want to talk about still. These are just a few things that bug the hell out of me on Windows that I did not have any issues with on Linux. The first is the way that my folders are set up. On Windows, I can set a folder to be in list view. I will go to another folder, hit back, and the folder I just set to be list view will not be in list view. I'll go to folder options, I'll do all that stuff. It will still not work. It will constantly reset itself. On both Mint and Cashy, I can just set it to be list view and it works. I don't remember if it's on both or just one of them, but one of them lets me also say, for these types of files, if a folder has all pictures or all music, be this view. Then it'll apply to all those folders like that, and it will just always work. It will always be that. Another thing that I liked is that both of these distros come with some pre-installed apps, and I was able to uninstall them, and that was it. On Windows, there are things that I cannot uninstall, or things that I can uninstall, but they will constantly be added back. I don't know why Microsoft thinks that Outlook is the most important thing on my computer, because no matter how many times I uninstall it, despite the fact that I never installed it in the first place, it will keep coming back. With Linux, one of the things I hear a lot of is that you own your computer. Your computer does what you tell it to. And that's what I felt like. If on Linux, I wanted to uninstall Firefox in some system critical application, I could do that. Even if it will break my computer, I can do that. So that was great. In addition to the last thing that I want to talk about, which is one of the first things I did when I first logged into Mint, the very first thing I did, is I wanted to change how my date and time were set up. So I right-clicked it in System Tray and changed it. And I laughed because on Windows, I have to like American Ninja Warrior my way through like 13 different advanced menus just to find this one option, maybe like a regedit somewhere. It truly feels like Mint and Kashi are operating systems that are designed by people who use operating systems on a daily basis. It's intuitive, which is what an operating system should be. So overall, both of these distros had a little bit of a learning curve, especially Kashi. That one took a little bit longer to get the hang of. But after using them both, I realized that I like them both for different reasons. Mint is definitely a set it and forget it type of OS, which is perfect for my media computer or my laptop, which, like I said before, I just don't use very often. Or in the case of my media computer, I turn on once a day for like an hour to watch something. However, Kashi is a better fit for this computer, which is my main one, because I play video games on this, I edit videos on this, I watch YouTube videos on this. I have three different monitors as well with different refresh rates. The one in the middle has one, and the two on the sides have the same refresh rate as themselves. And because Kashi uses Wayland, it just works. There's no issues with different refresh rates, whereas on Mint's X11, that wasn't great. The quick updates on Kashi will take a little bit of getting used to and hopefully will not break my system. But it is nice knowing that if I ever want to play a new game or down the line when I update my hardware, it will likely be supported by the time I get around to it. I'm still going to keep an SSD with Windows on it for the anti-cheat games or to record music. My Neural DSP plugins did work on Linux, but they were buggy and just kind of hit and miss sometimes. So instead of like tinkering with all that, I'm just going to leave all that on Windows. But honestly, I don't really play a whole lot of anti-cheat games. I don't record music that often, but when I do, I post it on my other channel, which is linked down below if you want to check that out. So that's the plan. My media computer already has Mint on it. It has had that for about 5 weeks now, and I've had no issues with it whatsoever. My laptop, I'm probably going to reinstall Kashi one more time just to kind of go through some steps. I'm kind of trying to create a wiki for myself just to have all the commands that I need to install stuff and to do the things I want to do. So that way, when I get this computer on Kashi, I just have to follow the steps. The plan is with this computer is I'm going to wait until Black Friday comes around because I need to replace some hard drives on this. I'm still using two spinning disk drives and I want to get another M2. Just a bunch of hard drive replacements I need to do first, and I want to go into Linux completely fresh. So hopefully early December I should be on Kashi here. And when I am, that'll be it. I won't have any Windows devices at home outside of my work computer, which I don't really have an option for. Best of all, too, when I turn on that media computer that has Mint on it, I just feel safe, I guess, is the best word that I can use to describe it. My data isn't being sent to anyone to analyze. A creepy entity isn't taking screenshots of my desktop. And I realized that for the first time in a long time, I don't feel a little anxious when I turn on my computer. So transitioning to Linux takes care of a lot of the de-Microsofting I wanted to do, but there's still the de-Googling part of my life that I'm still interested in doing. I've been poking around with stuff related to that, and I think that now that I'm on Linux, that's where I'm going to spend most of my time, is figuring out how to better de-Google my life. One thing I've been doing a lot of lately is updating my privacy settings on accounts or deleting accounts I don't use anymore, and also requesting my data from these companies. And I'm finding that that is a very annoying process. I've experienced some pretty concerning things related to that, and I'm very excited to talk about that in a future video. So make sure that if that sounds interesting to you, you subscribe. But as I said before, this is a gaming channel. So if that's not your thing, maybe just hit the like on this video if you liked it. And that way the algorithm knows that you like this video and it'll give you the next one for free. But that's it. Thanks for watching. Let me know what your thoughts are down below. What operating system are you using? What are your thoughts about the distros that I picked? Or anything else that might have piqued your interest? Love you lots. I'll talk at you eventually.